So thanks everybody for coming today. Very much looking forward to this. This is the first open seminar of the academic year, the algorithmic form, which has been curated by Alessandro Bava. Alessandro is very familiar to the Bartlett. He taught last year in the MArch architectural design course and also previously in MArch AD with theory. So we're really happy to welcome him back to bring forward a provocation. And I am really much looking forward to all the presentations today. It should be really interesting. If you are a guest and you are listening in, please feel free to use the chat to ask questions, have conversations, make provocations. There'll be a round table after the presentations where you can bring those discussions forward, but I'll be keeping an eye on the chat as well. And if the presenters could also keep an eye on the chat for any questions they want to answer directly in the chat, feel free. We are asynchronous as much as we can with our open seminars and keeping conversations both digital, visual, and text-based here. So thanks very much, Alessandro, and I'm handing over to you.
Thanks, Molly. Thanks, everyone, for joining. Thanks to Bartlett and BPro for hosting this seminar. Thanks, Molly, for inviting me. I should say that this is an event, a seminar, that is, let's say, in preparation of an issue of the Prospective Journal, which will come out next year at some point, I think March or April. It is really a pleasure to have all our guests, which I will introduce shortly. Just allow me to say a few words on the seminar and on the journal and what was the motivation. I think the main purpose of today is to discuss specific practices, both artistic and architectural, with the idea that it comes out really from a need that I felt, especially teaching last year at the Bartlett, for a broader discussion that went beyond purely tools or fabrication methods and innovation in fabrication and digital design, to really expand the conversation on computational design to specific, I should say, traditions and legacies that in my view could help us really expand our tools with which we understand the computational design. My main provocation is that all design is digital today, so we should also stop sort of dividing architecture from computational and non-computational. So with that in mind, I think some of the speakers will present the work of architects who, in some cases, architects, but also artists, who worked really with really early formulations of certain technologies that today are more pervasive. So I'm gonna stop that. I hope we can have a discussion on this. It is really, frankly, exciting for me to be discussing, architecture and design and questions that are really purely focused on that. So I hope that in the discussion we can really expand on that. I'm gonna now introduce our fabulous speakers. I'm going to start with Roberto Bottazzi, who I believe is the head of the history theory department at the Bartlett. He's an architect, researcher, and educator based in London. He studied at the University of Florence in Italy and the University of British Columbia in Canada before moving to London. His research analyzes the impact of digital technologies on architecture and urbanism. Our next speaker is Federico Rossi from Fundamenta Studio, which is an architectural practice based in Milan. Federico studied at the Accademia di Architettura di Mendrisio in Switzerland. And he worked previously at Christian Carrots in Zurich. And he has been teaching at the ETH in Zurich, I think probably not anymore, but for a few years in the past. And he, since 2016, he established this office in Milan called Fundamenta. And today he's gonna present, I believe, a few projects from his studio. Philippe Morel is an architect and theorist. He's the co-founder of EZCT Architecture and Design Research. He's an associate professor at the École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture Paris-Malaquais, where he co-founded the Digital Knowledge Program and Department. And he's a visiting studio master at the Bartlett School of Architecture He lectured and exhibited with the ECT at international institutions and published widely on computational architecture. His work is in the permanent collection of the Frax Center, the Centre Pompidou, as well as private collections. Provides, who was my colleague at Bartlett as well, is an architect and researcher. She studies the emergence of digital tools, their applications and impacts on urbanism. Her theoretical work maps a timeline of events around cybernetics, information and game theories, searching for system design tools that fall between the established fields of expertise. In her applied research, she explores the integration of readily available distributed tools such as BIM, blockchain, and AI. And lastly, Marco Vannucci, who is in fact the first one who's gonna present, is the founder and design director of Open Systems Architecture, graduated from the Architectural Association in London, where also we're colleagues, perhaps not in the same years exactly. His work has been published, published, exhibited, and awarded internationally, and is obviously based in London. So with that, I'm very happy to leave the floor to Marco, who I'm very happy for his contribution because he's gonna speak about the work of Luigi Moretti, who's an Italian architect. And I think we share a passion for this architect. And I think, you know, it's an architect who really experimented with very early, let's say, parametric tools for architecture. And he worked with a very famed Italian mathematician already in the 1920s. So it would be really, really interesting to bring back. I think his work has been popping up in certain places in the context of this specific discussion on computational design. But I'm hoping that today we can really expand on this legacy and on this work. So Marco, to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Alessandro. Thanks for inviting me, first of all. And it's very great pleasure. Let me share the screen. It's a great pleasure to be here today. Let me just presenting the work of Moretti, but also, like, you know, being in the company of great friends and esteemed colleague. So yeah, I basically, it's a good way to start, actually, because Luigi Moretti, it can be considered the godfather of parametric architecture, or at least it was the first architect to name it that way. So Luigi Moretti can possibly consider one of the most important Italian architects of the 20th century. He was active in Italy since the 30s, and he designed buildings such as internationally the Watergate complex in Washington, D.C., but also like a number of projects in Rome. And he was also known to be the founder of the Institute of Operative Research and Applied Mathematics for Urbanism, where he developed his research on the history of architecture, but also the possibility to apply algorithmic methods to architectural design. And of course, he's recognized to be the one who named, you know, the parametric architecture. Let me tell you something about the man himself, actually, because Moretti was born in Rome. He didn't die in Rome, but essentially he lived throughout his life in Rome, although he had, you know, a lot of commissions through his work internationally. But essentially Moretti was Roman to the core. He was part of Rome's artistic and business elite, and he benefited from all these privileges. So quoting the description of one of his collaborators, what Moretti imposing physicality extended itself in all aspects of his life. So his presence, erudition, and were commanding. He was a refined, eloquent, and always, as you can see, elegant man with strong conviction and intelligence. He was a proud citizen of Rome, but also he took pleasure in the physical form of the city. He loved his life, his culture, his society. So Rome, of course, is a place where tradition is prized highly, but also is a place of multiple contradictions. So for a true Roman, and definitely Moretti was one of them, these paradox and inconsistencies are norm of daily life, and Moretti navigate this context with pleasure and ease, let's say. One thing that is important to say is that Moretti also was, since young age, when he was a young man, but also he remained after the war, very closely linked to the fascist party. So he was a fervid Catholic, of course, but also his affiliation with the fascist parties cost him dearly, actually, with regards of, let's say, the lack of recognition as a central figure in Italian culture, or at least the recognition he could have aimed for. So, for example, Bruno Zevi, the famous historian, was his best, on the one hand, his best interlocutor, but also one of his worst enemies. So the day Moretti died, Zevi wrote that he possessed an authentic temperament and an artistic integrated by, integrated by a remarkable culture and an extraordinary professional ability. He could have played a decisive role in the depressed Italian atmosphere, but a spasmodic desire for individual affirmation associated with greed for refinement and luxury brought his imagination back to an unbearable conformity. And this is just to set the tone on how essentially, on why essentially Moretti was essentially forgotten for from the official history of architecture for nearly 50 years. Of course, Manfredo Tafuri hardly ever mentioned him or never mentioned him in any of his book as well. So the first phase is characterized before the war. He started work in 1933 and all the way to 1943, where this period is coinciding with his favor with the National Fascist Party, for which Moretti was acting as the chief architect. So in parallel to this, you know, this project here, which is the Casa dello Scherma, which is essentially a sport venue or a venue dedicated to sport. It was also part of the master plan for the Foro Italico, which is a new development in the north part of Rome, established by the regime, dedicated to sport. And then he was involved in a series of residential project in Rome, but also overlooking many development throughout Italy. After the war, he disappeared for 2 years. Nobody knows where he's gone, but in 47 to 59, let's say, he developed relationship with the Roman aristocracy and politicians, of course. So he partnered with developers and business people essentially, and he developed a series of beautiful projects, mid-century architecture such as this one here. It's a apartment block in Rome, but also very famously Casa Girasole, which is an apartment block in Rome in the Parioli neighborhood, which present a delicate facade but also a theatrical abstract facade, let's say, which is actually counteracted by a cave-like entrance hall. This project, like many projects in Moretti, actually presents some sort of ambiguity of language, let's say. And this ambiguity, let's say, also led this project to be included in Robert Venturi's Complexity and Contradiction in Architecture. And some argue even that Venturi's project for his mother, the Vanna House, was inspired by Casa Girasole. Always in this period, there's this project, which is a beautiful modernist intervention in the city center of Milan, with stunning example of, again, modern architecture. But also Moretti was, despite being banned completely from academia for his political views and ignored by the prevailing left-wing cultural elite of the time, was also a very prominent intellectual figure. And this can be understood, Moretti actually understood himself, I think, and can be understood as an epigon of the humanist tradition. That tradition that links the Renaissance to modernity, let's say. So, and this sort of characteristic of his way of thinking is also expressed in his love for books and sort of some project that he developed throughout his career. And I'm gonna show you a couple of them that I think are perhaps marginal, let's say, but I think also they very much sort of unveil this very refined, intellectual sensitivity. So the first one is a book that is published with the French art critic Michel Tapier, with whom in 1960 Moretti also co-founded the International Center of Aesthetic Research in Turin, which was an institution that basically was aimed to facilitate the study of art. So with Tapier, Moretti published this book, which is called Le Baroque Généralisé, Manifeste du Baroque Ensembliste. Sorry, pardon my pronunciation, but where he tried to basically tried to reconstruct the principle of Baroque architecture by means of mathematical formulas. And it's a very beautiful, exquisite, and very rare, actually, book. The second one is a collaboration that he established with Pierre Pascal, which was essentially the Apocalypse, written by St. John and translated by Pierre Pascal in French. The publication was accompanied by 16 woodcut prints from the Apocalypse's Cum Figuris by Albrecht Dürer, and were taken from the original woodcut that were used to print Dürer's work in 1498. So Moretti considered this book to be his masterpiece in general, absolutely. So you can see, like, you know, of course, a passion for the Baroque art, but also the idea of spirituality and are all aspects that were very dear to Moretti, and eventually he tried to also bring together in his parametric manifesto, let's say. So from 1950 to 53, Moretti published the magazine Spazio, which was actually named after the art gallery that he founded in Rome. And the aim was actually to find a connection between different forms of art. So definitely architecture, but also sculpture, painting, film, and theater. So in this case, Moretti was not just a publisher, but he was essentially acting as the editor. He wrote most of the texts. And he was selecting the images himself and also preparing the layout of the pages. So essentially Moretti, he didn't actually leave behind a comprehensive book or a theoretical book, but let's say that the seven issues of Spazio magazine represent his theoretical legacy, let's say. So Moretti, in the first editorial for Spazio, he elaborates a reflection on the integration of various art forms based on the concept of unity of language. So I quote here, there are some periods of civilization that take shape and character from the splendor of a single language. Others, very rare, in which the various expressive languages find a harmony for infinity of agreements, and together they reach a dense maturity. They are the happy times of Pericles or the early Renaissance or the extraordinary 17th century. A unitary language is born, formal process of sorting and classification of the infinite parameter of reality and their relationship. Space thus become unitary, resolvable, expressible in every point, and mirror of a new balance, unity of mankind. So Moretti here, of course, like, you know, is very aware of the different expressive languages. However, he tries to find through parametrics a way to create interrelationship. So for him, form is also understood as pure interrelation, and order and coherence is also resolved by the architect. So again, in this case, while he advocates for this new sort of algorithmic paradigm, Moretti also stands in the wake of the classic and claims the centrality of the role of the architect. In the article, always on Spazio, the value of profile, he declares his interest for profile and cornices. He laments the lack of it in modern architecture, and he argues for their value, the debate that is based on the capacity to give life to a bare facade of the building. In other texts, they talk about Baroque sculpture, and in particular, he discusses how drapery, the wings, the rocky landscape, or the ray of light of clouds of Baroque sculpture are not secondary importance, and they take a life on their own with respect to the work they belong to. So again, the process of abstraction of figurative elements and their formal autonomy, let's say, it's informing the way he understand and conceive architecture. So here is an example of a villa he built on the seaside in Rome for some wealthy client, where you can see like an idea of like a corniche or articulation of like fluid geometries. And another project, residential project in Rome, that definitely resembles some of the love for Baroque architecture. In 1953, he writes two texts, Structure as Form and Form as Structure, where really explicitly start to introduce the idea of parametric architecture. He continues this investigation, another article, Structures as Sequence of Spaces. Moretti proposed a special reading of several architectural work from Villa Adriana to Guarino Guarini, Church of San Filippo Neri, which is conducted with the help of a series of like plaster cast model, which they represent the interior negative space of the building itself. And so, and then of course, like he accompanies with plans and diagrams showing, let's say, what he calls the pressure exerted on the envelope of the building by the interior space. So again, Moretti very much focused on the question of form. He wanted to demonstrate how extraordinary architecture materialized sequences of spaces that are developing in relation to the visitor path, the change of perspective, and also the timing of the visitor journey, let's say. The parameter, therefore, are the geometrical form itself, the quantity of volume, the density, and what he calls the energetic pressure. Moretti also noticed how in Renaissance building, like for example, the Palazzo Ducale, the top left model here, is basically composed from the alternation of spaces that are essentially of the same geometry, they just vary in size. And therefore, you know, he declared his interest for the Baroque architecture, especially Michelangelo Borromini, because of this juxtaposition of special event is completely abandoned in favor of more continuous articulation of the space. So what we now call a total fluidity of space. And for this reason, also Moretti considered Baroque architecture as the beginning of modern expressions. So Moretti already started to actually lay out this principle for parametric architecture through the writing in Spazio and so on. However, in 1954, there is a turning point. He befriends and form a very strong partnership with the engineer and mathematician Bruno De Finetti. De Finetti had previously been involved in studies on the economic viability of construction. His cousin, the architect Giuseppe De Finetti, had invited him to develop a mathematical approach where, thanks to mathematical formula, they establish a relationship between land value, cost of construction, and rental value. And they calculated the optimum massing of the building based on these parameters. Such an approach, of course, would be further investigated by De Finetti by Moretti and De Finetti together in collaboration. It's also worth noting that De Finetti was a scholar and one of the first ones to introduce the idea of ricerca operativa or operative research, which is a branch of applied mathematics, which was emerging at the time, especially in the Italian academic environment, was new, and essentially consisted in analyzing and resolving complex decisional problem through the development of mathematical model as supporting insight in the decision-making process. So this collaboration, of course, it started, but Moretti didn't want just to, he wanted to go beyond actually a declaration of theoretical principle, let's say, and together they became president and vice president of the Institute for Mathematical Operative Research for Urbanism, which is also an institution that, you know, that will be also involved in real projects. So 2 years before his death, Moretti described the concept of parametric architecture in a manifesto published in Moebius magazine. And he calls for a new architecture that was rigorous in the definition of form, through the help of mathematical logic, computer techniques, and method of operative research, again, and which could overcome the empirical state of current architecture. I'm not going to read them all, but essentially the rejection of empirical decision, exact and complete definition of architectural themes. One that I thought it was actually interesting, affirmation of the architect's freedom in decision and expression only if it doesn't affect the characteristic determined by the analytical investigation. So I think, you know, there's a lot there to, you know, quite ahead of his time in a way. So this new theoretical framework was inspired by the group theory by mathematician Évariste Galois. And as I said, Moretti used the term parametric to indicate the possibility to design building through the interrelation of parameters. So essentially, he understood the building as something that could be expressed through a series of parameters that could be regulated by mathematical equation and so on. Famously, the exhibition Architettura Parametrica at the Milan Triennale in 1960, he presented four prototypical projects, let's say, one football stadium, a tennis arena, a swimming pool, and a cinema. And the idea was to actually set them as a test bed for the application of a more scientific approach to the challenges of the post-war reconstruction. In 1958, which is the same period of the collaboration with De Finetti, Moretti was commissioned to be ahead of a pool of architects to design the new Olympic Village for the 1960s Olympics in Rome. And there was like a new building complex that was built on a plain in the north part of the city. The other architects were Caffiero, Adalberto Libera, Amedeo Lucicenti, and Vincenzo Monaco. From an architectural standpoint, the project is essentially a modernist project. It's kind of like an organic way of master plan, but also formally quite homogeneous. The different architectural structures are made uniform by some common elements, such as the pilotis, of course, the ribbon windows, concrete swing course, and the yellow brick curtain cladding. Also, there's like a flying bridge that was designed by Pierluigi Nervi to cut across the site without interrupting the site itself. De Finetti and Moretti also were involved, actively involved in the master plan of Rome, so more urbanistic project. And their approach to urbanism was very much based on statistical model and simulations. So I think that's where they focus in the last part of their collaboration. And in particular, they work on the decongestion of the city center of Rome. This project that I'm showing is the parking underneath Villa Borghese, which is still operating and serving the city very well. And it's one that they carried out together. And then the late part, which is more international, of course, the project for the Watergate, which I believe was actually also developed, were the first project to be developed with an IBM machine, and became famous for the political scandal in the US, but also a sanctuary in Israel, the Stock Exchange Tower in Montreal, and the thermal center in Fuji. I want to just finish with maybe a provocation, or at least what can be considered a critical reflection of Moretti on his work. And I'm going to read it very quickly. So authentic humanism in ancient civilization was precisely synthesis and integral consciousness of abstract thoughts, of empiricism, of fantasy. For the reason, humanism in the modern world is Bacon, Alberti, Vinci, Galileo, and the last and splendid Leibniz. It is with the Enlightenment that an approximate rationality entered production of algorithmic thinking as something absolutely proper, acceptable, characteristic of mankind. The whole critical situation of today's world, from ecology to ethics to economics, politics, religion, and spirituality, is the result of two errors that started from the Enlightenment and then extended conforming our current thinking. Precisely, the logic of limitless algorithmic development, this logic is valid whatever the dimension of the empirical field on which it operates. Technology produces mechanisms that are expression of a particular logical chain. It is not possible to continue with them endlessly. In the law of technological development, there is a need for a limit. It is necessary to identify the limit of the law of development. There is a point for each technology beyond which it is vain, crazy to proceed. The limit of a technology is always inherent to it. We take logic and its algorithmic development as valid, whatever the size of the empirical field on which they operate. This is false. The logical structure are not valid for every dimension of the field on which they affect. Thank you.
Thanks, Marco. Amazing. Looking forward to discuss more later. Please, everyone, to all our guests who joined more recently, at the end of the session, we will have a discussion to which all of you are invited to contribute and participate. Now we turn to Roberto Bottazzi. Very happy that he agreed to be with us today. I'm not sure if this is true, but perhaps this is the first time you actually present the work of Leonardo Mosso in a dedicated, let's say, presentation. Leonardo Mosso is an Italian architect, as well as Moretti. Roberto spoke about, perhaps briefly, about this architect and his work in his fantastic book, Digital Architecture Beyond Computers, which is an amazing book that I advise everyone to get their hands on, which was very influential to also to some of the ideas that really fueled today's seminar. So I'm really excited to hear more, an expanded, let's say, version of what is present already in his book on Leonardo Mosso. So I'll leave it to you, Roberto.
Thank you very much, Alessandro, for both the invitation and the algorithmic form project. I will share my screen. I don't have sound, so it should be relatively easy. Please, you're seeing what you should be seeing, I suppose, the first slide of my presentation, right? Good. So again, thank you very much, Alessandro and Marco as well, for the presentation on Moretti. I did not know about this incredible book on the Baroque that he's written, amazing piece. Alessandro is right in the sense that beside the piece that is in the book, I have never really spoken about the work of Leonardo and Laura Mosso. So what I'll try to do now, please, if I run long, just let me know and you know, can shorten things. But what I'll try to do is, yes, to discuss it a little bit and try to give it an angle that may be relevant for the issue of algorithmic form, which is the broader, let's say, discussion that we are having. The first thing to say is that we should speak of Leonardo and Laura Mosso. There is, I think, a historiographical distortion, which we can relate to many factors, that has somehow always privileged Leonardo over Laura. It is true that Leonardo was older than Laura, but somehow the ideas are that they've developed have been developed together. So the first thing to rectify is to speak of them as a couple, not as a male architect with a female assistant. So who are they? Leonardo Mosso was born in 1926 in Turin. Unfortunately, Leonardo passed away exactly 1 year ago. And in 1962, Leonardo and Laura get married in a building that Leonardo himself designed. And they are working in Turin. So we are now basically moving from Rome to Turin, which is pretty much where all the story takes place. Leonardo in 1955 wins a scholarship to study abroad, and eventually convinces Alvar Aalto to hire him as an assistant in his office. And ever since, a collaboration and friendship with Alvar Aalto will be part of Leonardo's life. In many ways, you can say that Leonardo and Laura were the Italian architects of Alvar Aalto. So all the projects that Aalto did in Italy, and also the one that he tried to do and did not achieve to complete, were done through Laura and Leonardo, with the exception of the Finnish pavilion at the Venice Biennale, which is a commission that Aalto handled by himself. In the 1980s, due to, I think, massive incomprehensions on the type of work they have developed, they were developing, the municipality of Turin turns their back on the Mossos. They become pretty much forgotten. Leonardo from the 80s onward will start teaching in Karlsruhe, where also all of his latest work, which belongs more, I suppose, to the field of art than architecture, is. And of course, last but not least, in 2018 or 2019, the Centre Pompidou acquires a major part of their personal work and dedicates a room on the fourth floor of the museum on their work. And this is basically the day which the room is inaugurated. So, I don't know why this. The Leonardo career starts under the influence of his father. Yeah? His father was also an architect, and the first project that they co-design is the Chiesa del Gesù Redentore. We are mid-50s in Turin. The church is not far from Mirafiori, yeah? Which is of course the place where the old Fiat factory was. So it's symbolically also very important part of Turin. Shortly after, Leonardo begins his solo career, if you like, and the first project that he works on, the first piece of architecture that he works on and builds, is La Cappella per la Messa dell'Artista, which is an underground chapel right in the center of Turin, 61 to 63, in which we see the first kind of elements of his language appear. His language, to be very clear, is basically completely built around the idea of discretization of the architectural component. So all the buildings are always made of these parts. This in particular one is basically a 5 by 5 centimeter wooden element. It get layered in a variety of ways to provide both spatial and structural integrity to the project. This, as I said, are also the years in which he meets Laura, and Laura's impact on the work, I think, is profound, so much so that, like I said, it doesn't really make sense to speak of them individually. It is important to say that Laura had a proper formal training in art and had a deep knowledge of semiotics, linguistics, structuralism. So she, I think, introduced a kind of theoretical component in the work that was essential and made the work grow quite substantially. So in this first part of the presentation, I'm just trying to locate them somewhere and show you some of the key projects. Between 68 and 69, the project that perhaps today is often used to talk about their work is Città Programmata. Città Programmata is a theoretical project for a basically a city, a large territorial form of urbanization based on discrete elements and auto-projectazione, that is, the possibility to self-design these discrete elements in order to provide through architecture a means for democratic expression. The project, I'll go back to it later on, but is, like I said, perhaps their most famous project. In 75, this installation, always in Turin, Nuvola Rossa, again explores this idea of the discretization of the element and the play with the node in order to create quite complex geometrical articulations. Nuvola Rossa means red cloud. And I think that Marco was right to point out where Moretti's political alliances were. I think I should be also clear in saying that perhaps the Mossos sat at the opposite end of the spectrum in terms of left and right political positions. So Nuvola Rossa, of course, the red is more than just the color of the installation. This is another image of work that was often developed first and with students and for students and then developed further. In 1971, they enter the competition for the Centre Pompidou, so La Comune della Cultura. Again, I think the title has a clear, the commune of culture has a clear political angle that talks about how a certain, let's say, formal, and in a certain moment we'll see also algorithmic approach serves a certain political view of reality, of how societies should be organized. The building is basically a large storage space with basically a voxelized structure that can be populated and changed over time to adapt to the different programmatic needs that that the Centre Pompidou may encounter in the future. There are also a few interesting drawings of the variations of this structure and how it can be created to distribute voids and be changed over time. Now maybe we can take a little bit of a detour and talk a little bit why the work is interesting today to look at. Okay, today we also feel that we have buildings that are, you know, incredibly similar in a way to the commune of culture of the Centre Pompidou. These are, although not really built with the same, let's say, socio-political agenda behind it. And these buildings are also designed with a strong algorithmic, let's say, culture behind it, right? So these buildings are organized through robotics. This means that in data, this means that their organization is completely open, is completely, it brings up basically a different notion of form. and I think what is interesting is that because of this kind of buildings are emerging in architecture, we are increasingly getting interested into computational methods and computational sciences and using them to, let's say, affect architecture. So what I find interesting in the work of the Mossos is the exact reversal. So we don't have somehow an attempt to use computer science to colonize architecture, but we have architecture that colonizes computer sciences and specializes computer sciences algorithmic approaches. Yeah, so maybe this will come a bit more legible in the next part of the presentation. So how does the work operate? As I said, central is the notion of discretization of structures, and with that, the notion of how a joint, basically our node, how the articulation between parts takes place. Throughout their work, their career, they developed four types of nodes. that each in each one of them, they try to achieve a higher degree of freedom in order to achieve both the, let's say, the socio-political agenda that is animating the work, and to create a kind of spatial configurations, right? So the way in which these nodes work can be all algorithmically computed, and there was work done to do that. In some cases, the work was done with an actual computer. In some other cases, there was only the pseudo script, the pseudo language, let's say, to script it, but never really done through an actual computer. So for me, this is very interesting how they use the node and how they use it algorithmically. I'll take another small detour to talk about, let's say, how the idea of data and form can be related to one another. So the issue of algorithmic form. And in this sense, I think that the algorithmic form in itself is something that comes from the search for devices that allows us to coordinate something that we don't really understand, something that is random and unstructured, with something that can be made intelligible, that is readable by the human intellect. So the combinatorial game that the Mosso played around the notion of the node is their system through which, let's say, architecture of knowledge can be mobilized, can be made to work in order to invest, to become a search mechanism for spatial configurations, and almost a way to compute space, compute the world, let's say. So the work that they developed through the node and through its algorithmic construction is one in which knowledge can be freed and mobilized to be used for design. So basically, the node is a system through which knowledge moves from a non-intelligible domain to an intelligible one and be used to speculate, basically. Now, for me, this is very similar to a piece that Gilles Deleuze wrote in 1967, was published later than that, but was actually written in 1967, that is titled, How Do We Recognize Structuralism?, in which Deleuze speaks about basically gives his own assessment on structuralism and speaks about the possibility to use structuralist thinking in a way that somehow never achieves this issue of identity, of representation, of signification, but he makes a reading of structuralism as a way to mobilize knowledge, to in fact open up new possibilities. So I think that is a very interesting angle through which to understand the work of the Mosso and how these nodes operate as systems to make architecture dynamic and, as I said, mobilize knowledge. There's one thing that Deleuze says, which I think is also relevant. He says that basically the key for this element is the presence of an object that cannot be identified. Yeah? He calls it object X. So every structure has an object X, meaning an empty element in the series that allows all the other elements to move and allows all the other elements to be defined as cardinal numbers. So and this element, this void, as I said, is what articulates this series, basically, what allows the proliferation of new signs to emerge. This is very interesting idea because, as you can sort of see from these, perhaps not the best quality images ever, but the nodes in muscles are always a void. Yeah, the node, if you look more carefully, is always identified as a void around which a series of other elements intersect. And this, it is exactly the presence of this void that gives degrees of flexibility to the node. If objects were always meeting at the point, it would be much more difficult to articulate difference, to articulate, let's say, differentiation. And at the same time, if they were to meet in the same point, the object, the structure would lose its discrete nature. There would be notion of continuities that would need to emerge. And of course, discreteness, yes, it's a static category, but it's also a political one, because a discrete object is one that can be mended, can be changed, can be adapted. Yeah? So I think that in this notion of the void, or if you like, or the collapse of the structure in a structuralist sense, lies a very interesting way to think about the work of the muscles and to think about what form is under the condition of algorithmic thinking. Again, forgive me if I'm a bit cloudy in my presentation. These are preliminary thoughts. Hopefully they will get better. So I want to show you a number of other examples in which this void in the node allows for structures to become dynamic, or if you want to take a more dynamic, dramatic term, to collapse. So we are now late 70s, early 80s, and Leonardo and Laura are working with a ballet company in which these structures can be adapted to the body and somehow deal with the dynamics of the body. So at the very small scale of the body, but of particular interest to me have always been these works, the 1981. This is a small exhibition that Laura and Leonardo organized on the Piemontese territory. And in this particular case, we see these structures being used at the territorial level. And I think this is a very interesting use of what I would call an algorithmic thinking, because in this particular case, the structures are placed onto the landscape, they adapt to it, and they somehow allow the production of new signs based on the physical properties of these structures that are adapted. So a bit like a cipher, they become a communication device between an unstructured and a structured domain. In this case, unstructured territory and structured through the project. And a quite beautiful series of drawings also accompanies some of these speculations on territorial use of algorithmic thinking. I'm about to wrap up by returning to Città Programmata, which I briefly discussed before, this time perhaps to focus on the actual algorithmic work that is developed for this project. So these are simulations of basically growth of Città Programmata. They have been developed with a computer programmer called Sergio Rossato. Sergio Rossato was an engineer at Olivetti at the time. Another important, let's say, brick in the history of the post-war Italian culture. And represent one of the first attempts, at least in Italian architecture, to use computation literally in design. As I said, there's another element, I think, which is very interesting and radical in their work, which is the project that basically marks the end of their engagement with the city of Turin. So the municipality commissions Laura and Leonardo to refurbish basically a block in the center of Turin. And the project they come up with is an idea in which the entire complex is voxelized, and through voxelized thinking, there is basically a digital twin, the possibility to create a digital twin that will curate not only the design of the object, but his life after the construction of the object is finished. So it's also a management system that allows the building to be managed in the future. So what is interesting about this? Well, one is, of course, you could say that BIM in the 1980s wasn't exactly that popular. So the project has a certain originality in that sense. But for me, it's also very interesting the fact that we have so-called computational architects looking at historical architecture and applying applying computation to it, meaning applying something that is normally understood to be only appropriate for new architecture, they are actually applying it to existing architecture. There are also some other beautiful models of this voxelized reconstruction of the managerial, if you like, structure of the building. As said, unfortunately, the municipality wasn't really ready for it, and they didn't quite pick up the originality of the thinking. I will stop it here just to say that I think that this relationship between algorithms, freedom, politics, discretization provide not only an interesting page in the history of architecture to revisit, but could say something about also algorithmic form now, basically. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Roberto. This was really fantastic. I'm so happy that we got to know, to find out more about Leonardo and Laura Mosso. It's really amazing. I think most of us probably were not familiar, if not at all, knowing this work, and it's really stimulating. I hope, I saw that Gilles is present and he's with us today. So I would be curious to hear from him later, perhaps in the discussion. There is quite some adjacencies that would be interesting to explore later. Now we will turn to Federico Rossi.
It's us.
So he together, sorry, before I forgot to mention, you obviously run this studio together with Francesca Gagliardi, and today you will be, I think we fast forward to today, sorry.
I'm alone. Francesca, unfortunately, she's on construction site, so.
Yeah, exactly.
I look alone.
in fact, we will make a kind of fast forward to today, because Federico will present, I believe, some of their practice projects, which Federico was a guest also in my course last year. He did a fantastic lecture on these projects, and we engaged in a very interesting production on how they are using in a very peculiar and interesting way, let's say BIM software to develop very outstanding, interesting projects. So I'm glad that they joined us today and looking forward.
I think you see my screen.
Yes.
Basically, as you said, the office is run since 2016 by Francesca and me. It's an honor, and also we really thank you, Alessandro, to give us the possibility to write a text, because we are a practice involved really in the process making of building architecture. And it's so interesting for us to have time to write down things that we are putting in practice, and we can also, we would like to a little bit to theorize. Fundamenta is a practice that operates mostly in Italy. We form ourselves in foreign context, mostly in Switzerland. And then we decide to come back to Italy basically with the aim to build projects. So we really believe in the building process. And that's something that is, I really want to underline, because the Italian context is somehow different from other contexts in terms of building process. We are interested in construction of spaces. We see our project as the opportunity to make specific research on structural system and on the use of materials. We push materials to their limits and also against their limits. So we are really into designing through a systematic approach related to structures. And I'm glad that I hear two super interesting presentation. And I also have to say that I will really connect with the work of Luigi Moretti that we deeply admire as an architect. And so I will return later to Moretti. So basically, what is technology? I mean, we think that for our research, our organism, as we call our project, we are really into technology. So we use technology in direct way, using all the possible software that today can help us to visualize and design during the process. So we are really into all the VR, visual rendering, live, all we can get from what is exist, we try to use it somehow and experiment with that. What we would like to tell today is that is our, let's say, approach to technology is not really one-to-one, so direct to specific aspects of the project, but we are really interested in technology because we think that nowadays technology can give us as architects the possibility to go back to have a central role in the process. We were formed in a university through a system where the architect is the generalist, let's say, is the one being at the center of the process. And through the time, let's say, since the modern era, I would say, age, we saw a dismantled moment of the process, so a kind of division of different actors that were part of the process of the architecture. And technology for us is giving us the opportunity to go back to a central role. So like a political position, we see technology as an ultimate possibility for us as an architect to have back power in the process of building. And so BIM for us is just a potential starting point, because I think that is what I'm going to show. We are not stick to a software, but we believe that we believe in the system that when the architects has to be at the center of the process, also the actors has to go back to the architects. And this only possibility that we have to do that is through the control of a model, of a BIM model, let's say. We believe in this sense, and we didn't start our practice with this knowledge. Of course, it's still going on, but the first project we built was more like the scheme on my left side. So we went through multiple distortion of the project given by the different actors. They enter during the project, and you don't have, as architect or most of us, we don't have the instrument to sort of govern this mass of quantities or mass of information we are required to answer. And that's why what we are trying to develop with our idea of BIM, because it is a kind of our interpretation of a BIM system, is really to be the one giving and sharing a certain language to the people working with us, with the actors involved in the process. That's why I like to talk a little bit about our sort of alphabet that we share. This is something that we are developing since 3 years. That it's a sort of system of codes and parameters that we sort of design according to the way we are designing, and which define specific aspects of the project that are have to do with materials, cost, details, and specificity. And this is something that we design, I would like to say design, and then we implement it in a software. But let's say it's something that we add on a software. It's not like the consequences of a software. This is our sort of BEP, B-E-I-P, and it's something that we share with the consultants we are working with, engineer, HVAC system. So all the people working with us, they share sort of the same language. And basically, we see these, what we are seeing during our practice and through the project is that we really have control of the project from day zero, because sometimes BIM is intended as something that arrives mostly when there is already an execution plan. But what we do is really starting with these premises from day zero. So we are attempting to design a new sort of internal language, let's call it, to not allow different actors to bend the projects. We see actors in the process as really part of the design project. But that has to be done from day zero and not at the end. I mean, we don't see the point to make a BIM model at the end of the project, but basically from really the concept. And I just show three topics of three different projects that we did. The first one is a build project. It's a this winery in Piemonte. Of course, this is the first project we built. It was 2018 when we started in 17 and was finished in 2020. It's a project where, of course, we are deeply interested, as I said before, in structure and in using different systems. So here you see a system out of steel together as a system out of concrete. We are interested in creation of spaces. And in this case, our awareness of technology was limited to specific input. No, we use, let's say, technology in direct term to design and control the structure. In the specific case was the control of this formwork that we designed together with our engineer for this shell that was poured in once. And we starting from geometry and through technology, we optimize this form of the shell, and we divided, let's say, the formwork and all the panels. So we were really into a direct process of manufacturing, let's say. We didn't run the project as I was trying to explain. So it was not a project run with a sort of governance, but we were really into the battlefield trying to defend our project without having the instrument to govern the entire process of construction. And that's why from this project on, we understood we needed more sort of help or a new kind of system, internal system, to regulate the process of construction. And this started with a series of projects we are building in Sicily. And those are, let's say, houses near Noto, a super interesting Baroque town in Sicily. And in this term, we governed the process with a sort of BIM, our BIM instrument from the beginning, from really the concept. And I tackled this house that is a house mostly underground with, let's say, 20% of square meter that is above ground. And here we try to develop a system. Is the, let's say, the structural floor plan that is done through the radius of circumferences. And we try to develop a three-dimensional project where the space develop in the three axes and all the walls, the load-bearing structure is out of stone. To do that, basically, we through, of course, softwares, we optimize these lines that at the beginning were really spline to become radius. And through that, we develop our BIM model, let's say, according with all the consultants working with us. This is just a snapshot showing the mass of information we add at the end inside this model. And it's interesting because, I mean, putting information in a model is not enough to control it. You then have to have some instrument or rules to be able to make it possible, because this project has to be delivered on a construction company. And of course, nowadays, cost and money is like the quintessence more than often than of our profession. So let's say we are really connected to economy in more general terms, and to do that, we control our designing, and so our movements in design are also according to cost. That is something we found really interesting. And talking about this project and the process was sort of incredible how was easier to control it during the process through our sort of instruments. And for example, I like to show all this axonometry. We this code, each code, of course, is connected with a clear Excel chart that reminds to cost, quantities, and all the details that this specific part of the model has. And was also for us interesting to figure out a way of communicate the information. So this mass of information, how to communicate the information we are implementing in this digital modeling. And of course, this was something that we are still developing, but we find also in the practice of the making, this is after we start soon, quite understandable for people that has to build this house. Of course, just a couple of Excel connected or to this axonometry. In terms of design, we see the potential of using technology, something that allowed us to push further our research correlated to space and structure. And for example, here, all the walls are made out of stones, block of stones that are like 1 meter length, 50 centimeter height, and 30 centimeter depth. And through Grasshopper, we sort of customize each wall to be able to come out with a sort of abaco of all the walls with all the specification that this wall has to be, that of course are connected with number of cost that has to be able to be delivered to a construction company. Even though we believe as technology give us the possibility to really build in a certain amount of time, because nevertheless has to be said that if we relate to project of the past, time is something that we can really not negotiate. Maybe it's the only things we today is difficult to negotiate is time. And technology gives us the possibility to control time more than other aspects, so time basically money. We love to go back to models because we think that this ping pong between the digital tool and the making, the really making also during the process, give us the awareness of the reality. We don't have to lose the control of what we are thinking and designing. And of course we arrive at the end product. And the last aspects that I'm trying to show is with this house. And one of the project we started the construction site 2 months ago, where we think we arrive at a certain governance of the actors during the process in the beginning. This is a house where it's a renovation. We strip out the existing building out of the light wall. We kept the load-bearing structure out of concrete, and we insert inside a sort of steel structure and light and delicate surfaces that they cover and wrap up the building. The load-bearing structure is still the existing one. So we kept working the existing structure. And I mean, it was interesting to see that we started from the beginning with our consultants, so engineer, HVAC, all the possible actors were involved as a case study from day zero. So we designed together from day zero, trying to understand at the beginning all the possible potentiality that the realistic approach to these organisms could and should have from beginning. And I just show a couple of snapshots of what is the model we then deliver, but I'm really want to point it out that this is not the result of the process, but it's really starting from beginning. So it's not a model that was done at the end. So from structure, the entry in our model to the HVAC and MPE that was really designed together to the electrical system and to the finished organism. And it's really important for us to underline that, I mean, in the practice of making, what is architecture, basically? Architecture and architects has to be able to understand for us all the constraints and all the realistic things that happens in a building. Not looking at this as something passive, but sees as potential to push further design. And I mean, for us, this was not something really easy at the beginning to understand, because as we were trained, all the consultants and all the actors that are part of the architecture were always seen as something that comes parallel to the project. I mean, it's something that is a little bit like the scheme I showed. There are parallel lines that in certain point they intertwine, and in that moment you have a sort of connection. And for us, this connection has to be constant. I mean, and the only way we see it is through this system we are developing, where each part that is involved in the process has to be aware of the language we have to share together to achieve the project. And basically, this is just a snapshot of what is at the moment this house. So it's the strip out of the light walls, and this is the concrete. So basically, I just like to conclude shortly, saying that we see the potential also, or the discussion of today for us, that of course we are operating in a context that Italy, and we are facing the industry of building of Italy. So it's probably also specific, but we see it as a potential for us, this idea of, let's call it in more vulgar way, beam attitude as social impact, to give back to architecture the power they should again have in the process. So also a sort of social resistance to nowadays contemporary society. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Federico. Really grateful for this presentation. I think we start to see some threads. It was interesting to jump forward. We saw probably two examples of, could be an historical consecutio of like going from first experiments on algorithmic tools and computational tools designed to seeing an application and an application that bears, let's say, some positions on the role of the architect and how, you know, what is design and how do we take advantage of these tools. In fact, it reminded me of a presentation I attended with, actually organized by Philippe many years ago, where someone, a software engineer who developed one of the BIM softwares, showed a diagram that exactly, let's say, showed how the architect was not designed to be at the center of a BIM software, but actually somewhere else. So this is quite interesting. Also, together with comparing it to the work of Moretti and Mosso, both in different ways, try to develop new frameworks to think about like data science applied to design. So it's very interesting to see an application. So I hope we can discuss further later. My computer is running out of battery, but meanwhile, I will introduce again. So thanks again, Federico. I will introduce Provides, who was a colleague of mine and even attended one of my classes when I was a theory tutor back 2 years ago. And I sort of provoked Provides, who's a brilliant theorist and writer and educator, to reflect on the work of Isa Genskin, who is an artist, a very well-known conceptual artist. So we take a little bit of a leap, I guess, from this presentation and the next one from Philippe, where we discuss the practice of two artists. And I decided to bring this on because I really believe that in a discussion on, you know, what the title of today's seminar is, the algorithmic form, it is essential to also understand how artistic practices have employed algorithmic tools as creative tools, because we should never forget, and this is something that also came up in Marco's presentation, that of course architecture is the product of invention, is the product of fantasy, as much as it is also the knowledge of processes and the organizational processes. But you know, we should never forget that, and also this came up in the presentation from Roberto, that we shouldn't let, let's say, architecture to be colonized by computer science, but rather we should try to understand, let's say, the aims of architecture and grab and colonize computational tools and use what we need. Because this is quite a paradigm, it seems obvious, but I think it's a paradigm shift from especially the conversation and the discourse on computational design that for the past, I think, 20 years has focused, I think rightly so in many ways, on understanding computer science, understanding the innovations and bring them in, but it was more preoccupied with the process of understanding. I think now perhaps the technologies are mature enough and our knowledge is mature enough to then really integrate these technologies in how we think about design. And therefore it's interesting to discuss again the work of Isa Genskin, who in the 1960s developed a series of sculptures which were designed with a digital software and produced by a very early CNC machine in Germany. So not gonna spoiler anymore. Talk. I'm really curious to hear what your reflections are on Isaac Ensor.
Yeah, it's such a great pleasure to be among such a great panel. I learned so much. And thank you, Alejandro, for organizing this and invite me to write a piece on Isaac Ensor. And thank you, Molly, for making this event happen. I personally spent 3 years in Germany, and I actually came across her work in person a number of times. So the whole exploration makes me quite nostalgic. But I don't think I have seriously written specifically on art before, so I really tried to bring it in to the architectural social discourse and mingle out the relevancy. Isaac Ensor's work can be seen as a synthesis of the social and the object. So a visual sculptural art that reflects on a relationship between social happenings and the scale of the architectural space. A Ensor is something that one has to experience in person, and you would see why. She's also one of the early explorers in the use of computation for art, collaborating with scientists in the generation of algorithmic forms as early as the 70s. So, but first of all, what is the social object, and then what can it mean for architecture? So perhaps this is a good moment that we learn from art after hearing all of the architectural discourses and how it engages itself with the many manifestations of science while maintaining its structural integrity, so not to be colonized. Of course, to be an artist, both the art and the craft are non-discursive, and this produces a sort of information asymmetry where the process of the conceivement becomes quite opaque and is left for the wondering of the spectator. So it would be quite impossible to understand and begin to appreciate Ensor without looking into the context of her time. And this is indeed how I intend to pivot this brief introduction of her work. As Alejandro in his piece, Computational Tendencies, challenged the field of architecture to look at the rhythm of architecture and the sensibility of computation, Roberto's book on digital architecture gave us a signpost. So the urgency is not anymore how architectural space can be digitized, but ways in which the digital space can be architecturized. And as Philippe Morel had brought out in his computationalism, the algorithmic form is not anymore what can be visualized on the front end, but the relationship between computation and the information of computably generated objects. So within the discipline of architecture, we see an increasing amount of research that emphasizes the social parameters, from the use of big data in algorithmic social sciences to agent-based parametric semiology in form finding. So this ever-mounting proposal that promised to apply algorithms and neural networks to architecture and urban problems is evident of a press on social change, but also the urge to make full use of all the technologies at hand. So first, an algorithm is a finite sequence well-defined with performance based on the length of code, basically how fast and best can we describe the most. And in this respect, what stands at the convergence of the computable form and the science of space is the algorithmic social object. The word sociology is a hybrid coined from the 1800s. More specifically, social as the adjective came from the 1400s, devoted to or relating to a home life. And the domestic connotation of the term soon accelerated from the realm of the private to the public. So bloomed during the rise of a positivist worldview, sociology naturally claims itself to be a science of scientific methods and empirical investigation. This basically raises the question of computability. So what is the limit to social computation? And if there are none, then we might as well be a simulation ourselves. So the logic goes that there must be one. And in understanding such limits, it would help us to not leave an algorithm running, not knowing that it might run for infinite human lifetimes, which renders the question as oblivion. Just as Borel's monkey hitting keys at random on a typewriter, or how we try to insert promising algorithm here for arbitrary ear-catching urban grant challenges. Ear-catching. Okay, so what's the hook? This is a hook. A hook is basically a musical idea, often a soft riff, passage or phrase that is used in popular music to make a song appealing and to catch the ear of the listener. So after looking at this work of Ensor, I begin to wonder, what does a hook actually sound like? And I went to karaoke the other day just to scream things out, and I realized this is what a hook sounds like. Yeah. Yeah. So this is one of the most famous hooks of the late 2000s, the Empire State of Mind, which came about the same time as the Web 2.0 boom. So just after New York recovered from the dot-com bubble. The song was like an acoustic montage of the 8 million stories out there in the naked. It reveals an underlying urge for social change that was concealed by the boom. And just as we see Jay-Z was rapping, "The city is a pity, half of y'all won't make it." It was an epoch of R&B, rhythm of cities of the urban sphere. And just 15 seconds of rhythm is already enough to teleport us to Manhattan with every bit of romanticism that comes with it. So the rhythms and the blues constructed a virtual space of narrative and storytelling. And such kind of audio spatial quality taps into our affective experiences through the ear, and it reveals the urban condition through its lyrical expression. Of course, it is no accident that the 2000s was also a time when Asa Ganskin explored the potential of audio in its visual sculptural embodiment. So back to the ear that was stuck on a facade, it basically personifies the building as a listener, hearing out what the city had to say. So at that time, the body is objectified and made into a machine that processes external information. The ear also symbolizes the power of voice that could be filled at a place with a space, so a space of acoustics. The difference between a place and a space in this work is that a place is a location geographically tagged and works upon our identity and self-association of belonging, whereas a space can be virtual as much as it can be physical. So this is perhaps a prelude to augmented virtual reality that is described by Derrida as uncanny. I don't know why the slides are so low res. Let me just reshare it again. So Ram Kuhau shares a similar interest in his belief that it is not possible to live in this age if you don't have a sense of many contradictory voices. What Ganskin and Kuhau have in common, it's more than their continental philosophical European roots, but also their love for the Empire State. So Ganskin in 1996 published a collage book, I Love New York, Crazy City, whereas Kuhau published Delirious New York at a time when the city was on the verge of bankruptcy. But still, Kuhau saw Manhattan as a Rosetta Stone. He basically analyzed New York as if there had been a plan, with everything starting from the grid. It was to Kuhau's conviction that the rigor of the grid enabled imagination despite its authoritative nature. And you would also see such influence a lot in Ganskin's work. So unlike Europe, which has many manifestos with no manifestation, New York was a city with a lot of manifestation, but no manifesto. So Kuhau had his self-appointed task to write one with a sense of critical paranoia. It is a surrealist approach that blends together pre-existing conditions with illusions to map the many blocks of Manhattan into a literary montage. So the cover of the first edition of the book captured perfectly the surrealism of the city's social economy at the time. The Art Deco skyscraper Chrysler Building is in bed with Empire State. So both were in the race to the sky in the 1920s, fueled by the American optimism, building boom, and speculative financing. Surrealism is basically a paradigm shift of a new type of surprising imagery replete with disguised sexual symbolism. The architectural surrealism manifested in this delirious city is the chance encounter of capital disguised as national symbolism. An architectural hook. So techniques of assemblages is much used by Ganskin. She would amalgamate urban objects, which automatically elevate the artwork from an installation to the interrelationship of objects that construct an architectural sensoria. Ganskin's sense of scale actually also echoes with Kuhau's bigness. Her Amsterdam City Gate proposal frames and celebrates the empty space, and it found manifestation in Kuhau's enormous CCTV Beijing headquarters, a building as a city of endless air conditioning and information circularity wrapped in a structured window skin, hugging itself in the air by its downsampled geometry of a Mobius loop within a world that tends to the mega. So one is much reminded of the big data approach to form finding, perhaps also in the use of cellular automata, where the resolution of interconnections and information consensus becomes less relevant, turning data processing into an intelligent ever-mounting aggregation. And in this big data infused era, the scale of boundary between architecture and urban design turns to oblivion. Basically highlights our contemporary understanding in complex system sciences where the building is not an individual object, but within a complex fabric of social economic exchanges. And as Mario Kart will capture in his second digital turn, we no longer live in Claude Shannon's age where compression and bandwidth is of the highest value. As data storage, computational processing power, and retrieval costs diminish, many traditional technologies of data compression are becoming obsolete. Blunt information retrieval is increasingly replacing causality-driven teleological historiography, basically demoting all modern and traditional tools of storytelling. Genskin's work in urbanity is like a mirror held up high for us to reflect on our urban beliefs. She began architecturing a series of columns evocative of skyscrapers that are out of scale, and she named each one after one of her friends and decorated them with individual designs, sometimes of newspapers, found artifacts, and ready-made objects that reflect the happenings of her time. So walking amongst them reminds the audience of New York avenues and its urban strata, only at 1 to 500. And decorated with DIY store supplies, these uniform yet individuated structures seem to be documenting a history of the future of mass customization. As Carpo argued, mass customization technologies would potentially make economies of scale and its marginal cost irrelevant. So subsequently, the division of labor unnecessary, as the chain of production would be much distributed. The potential is to democratize the privilege of customized design to the common, but how can we ensure that such technologies would benefit the goals of social and not fall into the same traps of the attention economy and its consumerism? As refractive and reflected in Genskin's social facade, taped with ready-made nationalistic palette that are elusive of the semi-transparent curtain walls of corporate skyscrapers, one sees nothing but only a distorted image of the self being mirrored. As one begins to raise their phone and take a picture of Genskin's work, the self suddenly becomes the anomaly in this warped virtual space of heterotopia. And specifically, Genskin's heterotopia delineates how the other is differentiated through the images that have been consumed, basically a post-Fordism subjectivity that fulfills itself through accelerated information consumption. Now, of course, Genskin's engagement and interest with architecture can be traced back to the 1970s. She was really interested in ellipses and hyperbolics that she prefers to call hyperpole low. So the 70s was a time when a computer was a machine that fills up the entire room to which a normal person would not have access. So that's why Genskin got in touch with a physicist, computer scientist Ralph Krauss, who helped in a calculation of the ellipse with a computer and plotted the draft of a drawing with a drum plotter that prints on continuous paper. The artist saw the meaning in such algorithmic form differently than the scientist. So to Krauss, ellipses are conic sections. Colloquially speaking, an egg comes pretty close to an ellipsoid. An egg is composed of a hemisphere and half an ellipse. So if we're to generalize the concept of conic section, hyperbolas also belong to it. And if one rotates a hyperbola around an axis, a hyperboloid is formed. And this is indeed how the algorithmic form was generated in Genskin's work. So the algorithmic form has been rationalized by Krauss to its computational production, pretty much irrelevant of semantics, until it was physically produced and touched the ground of the cultural institution of a museum. And the 10-meter-long drawing was delivered full-size in one piece as a template to a carpenter. So already 50 years beforehand, Genskin's work explored the two-level of outsourcing structure that is pretty much iconic to today's digital architectural production. And the output of such exploration is a visual sculptural object of an algorithmic form at such an elongated scale and the extreme proportion that undermines not only the human agency in its conceivement, but also the sensorial perception of the architectural space. When contemplating Genskin's hyperbola, one is often reminded of the radical play with vanishing points at Hans Holbein's The Ambassador, where the anamorphic skull can only be viewed at an oblique angle, metaphorical of how one can only begin to appreciate the transience of life only with an acute change of perspective. And when situated in a different context next to Genskin's aircraft window, the hyperbola raises in association with other streamlined objects, such as that of missile, as a homage to what happened in 9/11. Perhaps the question of life and death paralleling scientific advancement is the later meaning and surrealist touch within Genskin's work, revealing how the invention of the apparatus is at the same time the invention of its cultural accidents. So referencing Paul Ferrilium, The reflection here is that we may be able to compute the car as a streamlined object, but we're not even close to being able to compute it as a social cultural technology. Perhaps the problem is not so much on whether the social is computable, but rather that we are trying to objectively rationalize something that is intrinsically social. This is not to say that the scientific method to social architecture are in vain, rather the opposite, that the science and its language should act as social economic drivers to changes in architectural production. So if architecture is neither just art or science, but an emergence of its own faculty, it should be able to argue for itself academically as a discipline with a language crafted for its own and to debate upon itself on its own standing grounds in its unique way of researching and speculating that are not all hats in the clouds, but revealing pre-existing social economic conditions. And it is only through understanding ourselves as a discipline can we begin to grasp ways in which we may start to contribute to social change. And not to say that we must reinvent the wheel every time we roll, but we must go beyond endlessly feeding machines with data and hoping it will either validate or invalidate our ready-made and ear-catching hypothesis. And here's where I shall leave you with one of Marie Carpo's beautiful quote, each to his trade, and let's keep for us what we do best. So thank you so much. That was all.
Thank you so much, Provides. I think this was an amazing, let's say, placement of a contextualization of Isaac Genskin's work within a larger discourse that touches also on architecture. And not only that, I was really interested in the research on those sculptures, because I think there is actually not so much information published, and it's never been discussed in such a way. So I think thank you so much for that. Hopefully it can feed the discussion as well later. So last but not least, we will turn to Philippe Morel. Philippe is an architect and theorist. I'm very, very glad for Philippe to be here. I think Philippe, for me, was a very influential figure, person. I think it kind of inspired a lot of my interest in this subject. So I'm very, and we've had over the years, I think mostly informal conversations and not so much like, not so many of these more public occasions. So I'm really glad to have one today. And I'm, I should say that I sort of in a way provoked Philippe to, you know, we discussed, let's say that he would be looking at the work of an artist and composer, Manfred Mohr, who is one of the early adopters, let's say, of algorithmic tools to make art and music. And I'm happy that we do that, that you will do that today, especially because I think you're well known, especially in this context, for your writing on technology and computation. And I know that you have a deep interest also in the more, let's say, artistic question that surround these technologies. So today, I think it will be interesting to hear what you have put together. So to you, Philippe.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Alessandro, for the kind introduction. Thanks, Molly, and Alessandro for the organization. So I will speak about Manfred Mohr today. I assume you see my screen, so things should be okay.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So yes, I will give a few information about this German artist, Manfred Mohr, who was mostly operational in the 70s and 80s. I really believe that this is when it was the most interesting, the 70s of the last centuries were extremely interesting years for Manfred Mohr. I'm a bit more skeptical about the 80s, but we'll discuss all of that. So let's start with a very quick introduction with Manfred Mohr. So he was born in 1938 in Germany. In West Germany, in between Karlsruhe and Stuttgart. He first trained at a local art school, but he didn't do much there. Then he moved to Paris. This is where he really started to be mostly most active. He studied at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, where he met some really interesting figures. And then he left to New York at the end of the, at the very beginning of the 80s, where he was living until today. His work is present in most of the very important collection in Western museums, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Centre Pompidou, but also the Reina Sofía Museum in Madrid and the PS1 in New York as well. So I'm giving this biographical information from Wikipedia after checking also from his own writing, from his own presentation, but it appears that Wikipedia is quite rigorous on that. So he got a couple of prizes. I mostly dedicated to electronic art. It didn't, let's say, like most of the algorithmic artist or the digital artist, he didn't have a very wide recognition beyond the domain of digital art, which is always a bit strange at some point, but it can be explained because these artists themselves, they mostly introduce or they mostly present themselves as digital artists, which I believe is a bit problematic at some point. Probably they should just consider art as a whole and the computer as something which is just part of the world. But when you are a pioneer, you are quite easily identified with the techniques you are using. And this is what happened to Manfred Mohr and what happened to most of his friends in the domain of digital art. Manfred Mohr started as a musician. He was a jazz musician. He played saxophone. And in fact, this is quite interesting because in his art, he was really looking for a kind of, let's say, a mix between the freedom, which is associated with jazz, and the precision, which is required by the instrument. So I really believe that this experience in as a musician is interesting if we want to understand what Manfred Mohr was interested in, both formally speaking, but also conceptually speaking. In his work, he's dealing with different kinds of techniques we will see a bit later, making use, for example, of pseudo-random generators, but also looking at different structural parameters, looking at the issue of emergence, even if he didn't call it that way, and also looking at different, let's say, visual expression that could be associated with the use of algorithms. So in the 60s, the context I will present is made of dachism, abstract expressionism, informal art, but also art, kinetic art, minimal art, and conceptual art. At some point, I believe that Manfred Mohr was influenced by many of these different art style or art movement. He tried to create a kind of synthesis between these different movements. And I think this will be very clear in what we will discover. So the first important exhibition by Manfred Mohr was organized in Paris. He met someone in Paris in 1967, a pioneer of computer-generated music, Pierre Barbeau. And thanks to that, he started to make use of computer in visual art. In he was also interested as a German who was capable of reading, of course, the writing of Max Benz, of philosopher Max Benz. He was interested in the philosophy of technique, of technology and communication. Max Benz was a rationalist philosopher, as we will see. But he tried to extend the domain of rationalism to the new techniques that appeared in the year 60s of the last centuries. So the first, the first important exhibition from Manfred Mohr was organized in 1971 at the Museum of Modern Art of the city of Paris. It was the first museum solo exhibition of work by an artist whose works were produced and drawn exclusively by means of a fully automated digital computer. So this exhibition is important. It's definitely a decisive moment. Here is a cover of the jazz band Rocky Volcano, in which Manfred Mohr was playing. So it's kind of fun to see that. So the Paris show here is a flyer. The invitation card for this Paris show. As you can see, the title is Une esthétique programmée, which means a programmed aesthetics. And the subtitle is Démonstration sur matériel électronique, Benson, traceur de cours. So demonstration on digital equipment and Benson curve plotter. So Benson is obviously the brand of this plotter. So during this exhibition, Manfred Mohr plotted a couple of figures generated by a computer, or I would say, in fact, not really generated by a computer. I would mostly say programmed by Manfred Mohr himself. I believe we cannot really apply the word generative design at that moment, because again, it was extremely deterministic, and mostly because generative design can of course also be deterministic, but mostly because it was so entirely programmed by Manfred Mohr that it's a bit ambiguous to speak about generative design. But in any case, this work was really interesting. Manfred Mohr was in fact doing experiments in France at the Meteorology Institute, and Pierre Gaudibert, who was the director of a research group at the Museum of Modern Art of the city of Paris, was so impressed by the work of Manfred Mohr being conducted at the Meteorology Institute that he decided to organize this exhibition. So what this exhibition was about? The exhibition was about presenting 20 drawings, but mostly printing them during the exhibition. So here are not the drawings that are presented by Manfred Mohr at the exhibition, but the preliminary drawings that he was doing in the US at the Brookhaven National Laboratory. He met a friend there who was working in this scientific laboratory, and he was able, I mean, this guy was Peter Kemi, and he was able, thanks to Kemi, he was able to plot with a light plotter to plot different kinds of figures. And he programmed these figures thanks to the Fortran language. So what is Fortran? Fortran is the first high-level programming language that was developed in the US in 1953 and 1954. It was developed by somebody called John Backus, as we will see, and we will see what John Backus was doing. So Fortran means formula translator. It's considered as a very important language in the history of programming language, but also in the history of computers. Again, as I said, it's the first high-level programming language. It's not the first programming language, obviously, but the first truly high-level programming language, which is also, of course, Turing-complete and completely rigorous. So it allows to program any kind of machines, especially scientific calculators that were mostly used at that moment. Fortran was so influential and so popular that it gave its name to many different kinds of events. For example, here, the Fortran 4 lectures organized in 1969 at the University of California. It's as part of the lecturer, we can count Konstantinos Doxiadis, who was also using Fortran as at his office in Athens at the Doxiadis Associate Computer Center, but also at his architecture office. And as I said, Fortran was supported by IBM, the main manufacturers of computers and probably the most influential in 20th century. It allowed to program most of the classical arithmetic operation. It's quite an easy to read language, but the only problem at that time is that despite the language was easy to read, it was not so easy to use, as we will see, because of the punch card system that was still in use at that moment. But if we look at what Fortran is about, we can easily identify the main structures, the main, instructions that we are still using today in most computer languages, like the conditional loop, the if-then loop, the do loop, which is iteration loop, but also the capability of selecting cases, so making use of pattern recognition at some point, which is very interesting and which made Fortran a very powerful language. So it was really a modern language at some point, which has more or less nothing to be ashamed by compared to the most contemporary programming languages. But as I said, the problem at that time is that in order to use a computer, people had to create punch cards. So this is a typical Fortran punch card that was created at the University of Stuttgart. And you see at the top of the card, you see the instruction, it's do one, KK equal I, comma N. So you see what this instruction was about. And here you see a Fortran card I created for myself with a simulator online. So I wrote my name and today's date. And you see at the top what this Fortran card is would be doing if it was put in this kind of old-fashioned computer capable of reading punch cards. So the difficulty was not really in programming, in writing a code. It was mostly what was mostly boring. And I think we need to understand that Manfred Bohr was programming the computer by himself, while most of the artists at that moment that didn't dare learning the programming language, they were doing collaborative work with scientists, but Manfred Bohr was doing everything by himself. So this was so important in his work that he even used some of this card as an invitation card and flyer in different exhibitions later on, for example, here in Switzerland, in Zurich, as you can see. So the punch card system was, again, it was extremely common, but it was extremely tedious as well. You first had to write on the coding form what you wanted to do mostly, and then you were giving this to people who were specialized in typing this Fortran code, mostly women at that time, for the early computers, women were mostly dedicated to implementing on the physical code what the mostly men were writing on this paper sheet. So as I said, Fortran's name comes from formula translating system created by John Backus and a couple of other programmers, obviously, part of his team. It's a general purpose language. It's an imperative programming language which has to be compiled. So imperative means that it's basically the most common type of programming language that we are using today. It has to be distinguished from functional programming language or logic-based programming language, for example. So just as a side note, the work of Backus is not limited to Fortran. John Backus developed with Peter Noor and Noam Chomsky the BNF, the Backus Noor form. It's a metasyntax notation which is still widely used today. This notation allows to represent any context-free grammars in a very easy way and mostly in a rigorous manner. So here is a quick example of the BNF form. So it allows to describe computer languages by making a distinction between the syntax and the semantics of the languages. And mostly thanks to this rigorous description of the syntax, it allows to write parsers. And the parsers allows you, for example, here to understand this, the meaning of this. And the meaning of this is simply A multiplied by B plus C. But of course, if you don't know the structure of the language and the syntax, and if you have nothing to describe that, there's no way you can write a parser because the language then would be ambiguous. So obviously you need to have something which is completely unambiguous when you want to do context-free to write context-free grammars, but also when you want to do programming. So let's go back to the Paris exhibition. At that time, it was quite fashionable also to allow people to participate and to give feedback. So there was this whiteboard at the beginning of the exhibition with the question, what do you think of the aesthetic research done with the help of a computer? So people were invited to answer and to give their appreciation of what it was about. So here you see Manfred Mohr at the Meteorological Institute checking the tape, the ribbon, the programs, the plotter. Here you see an image of the opening at the exhibition in Paris in 71. You see the plotter, and here you see a couple of drawings that were made at that moment by Manfred Mohr. So here are a couple of drawings that were presented at the exhibition. This one called Random Walk. This one called Logic Inversion or Logical Inversion. This one entitled White Noise. This one entitled Quark Line, which was also making use of random processes. And at the same time, Mohr, who was very much interested in randomness, also created this small book just full of randomly generated numbers. So I personally, I really like this book because It's not just visual, it's deeply conceptual. So what was a critical reception of this exhibition? It was quite good. Most of the articles were, not very long, but they were describing a very interesting exhibition. This was before the exhibition. This comment was about a small exhibition in Paris at the famous gallery Daniel Templon, who was one of the most influential gallery in Paris. And it's still a very influential gallery, by the way, in Paris. It more or less closed, but now he has a foundation, which is much more ambitious. But the comments on the exhibition itself were good, both in the newspaper Le Monde on the left, but also in the newspaper Le Figaro on the right. Le Figaro, just for the one who are not French, Le Figaro is a newspaper who published for the very first time the manifest, the Futurist Manifesto on February 20, 1909, at the beginning of the 20th century. This manifesto was written by Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, the famous Italian artist. So a couple of interesting concepts came along, but as you can see here on the right in the journal Hebdo, some people and critics invented new words like decinatic. Decinatic would be, I don't know how I could translate that. It could be like, because in French, computer science is called informatics. So decinatic is created on the same model as informatic. So it would be a kind of science, a kind of computer science of design, of drawing, most precisely, not design. But in any case, what was really in the air regarding the critics was that it was about a program aesthetic, and it was about the interaction between a machine and a man. But most of the discourse were really dedicated to an aesthetic analysis of what Manfred Mohr was doing, and very few discourses were trying to go beyond the sole aesthetics. So what was the context at that time? The context was the following. In 1968, there was an exhibition organized at the MoMA entitled "The Machine as Seen at the End of the Mechanical Age." So most people, including Pontius Hulten, the curator of this exhibition, Pontius Hulten later became the first president, the first director of the Centre Pompidou in Paris. And the exhibition organized by Pontius Hulten at the MoMA was speaking about all the art from the beginning of 20th century until 68. That was influenced by machines and mechanisms. And what was interesting is that Pontius Hulten understood that it was the end of the mechanical age, hence the title of the exhibition. At the same time, exactly during the same year in 1968, in the US, another exhibition was organized, a very famous one called Cybernetic Serendipity, and another one called Some More Beginnings, an exhibition of submitted works involving technical materials and processes, that both in New York, and the last one was organized by IT, which means Experiment in Art and Technology. It was a group of people, artists and scientists, working together. Another exhibition slightly later in 70 was organized, entitled Software Information Technology, Its New Meaning for Art. It was organized in 1970 at the Jewish Museum in New York. And finally, another one was organized, which was entitled Artist and Computer, with mostly a catalog which was imported. At the same time, also in 1970, a show was organized at the MoMA in New York. It was entitled Information, but in fact, it was a show dedicated to conceptual art. It was not so much dedicated to digital art, it was dedicated to conceptual art, but the title of this information was self-explanatory, and everybody could understand that we were entering a new world. So this new world is obviously the one of information, whose concept appeared in a rigorous mathematical way in the year 1928. And then later with Shannon in the year 1948. But I won't enter the detail of the history of information here, but let's keep in mind that Shannon, Wiener, and von Neumann were all extremely important and influential in the birth of this concept. So the context in industry was the same. It was also the beginning of the use of the massive use of computer, CNC machine, making use of punch cards or punch ribbon, as you can see here on a Siemens machine in Germany. In literature, the context was also influenced by information. The famous book by William Burroughs, The Soft Machine, was extremely influential. The title of the book was in fact even more influential than the book itself in terms of the influence on other kinds of art. It was extremely influential in literature, of course, but the title was really a shock. To give you a precision, William Burroughs was the grandson of the creator of the Burroughs computing company. The grandfather of Burroughs, whose name was also William Burroughs, by the way, was the inventor of the addition machine that made him rich and extremely influential. William Burroughs, the writer, was immensely rich. He never really had to work. He could just focus on his literature and playing around with guns. By the way, he killed his wife because he was a bit too playful. He was a very strange character, but he was a genius writer. So here you see an image of a Burroughs company. As I said, it was a very important company. It's not Burroughs, but just something about the punch cards. So the context in fact shows that some work associated with the use of computers came before the one of Manfred Mohr. So Manfred Mohr was not, let's say, properly a pioneer. He was not the first one. But still, it was very interesting in the way he analyzed in a critical and in a very smart manner what are the main parameters of digital art. Here you see the work of Michael Knoll that was created in 1964, and this work was presented in the catalog in the book Cybernetics Serendipity. On another level, at the same time in 1967, there were a special issue of Art Forum, which was published on the cover here. It's a work by Larry Bell, a conceptual artist. And in this influential issue of Art Forum was published The Notes on Sculptures by Robert Morris, but also an analysis of the work of Claes Oldenburg. As you can see, the title of the essay is Claes Oldenburg's Soft Machines. Obviously, these soft machines are associated with the work, with a novel by William Burroughs. but also in the same issues was published a very influential essay, another one by Sol Lewitt, whose title was Paragraphs on Conceptual Art. So at the end of the 60s, the art scene was extremely active, extremely interesting conceptually speaking and intellectually speaking. Slightly later, in 1978, some conceptual artists like John Baldessari presented a couple of works. This one is I Will Not Make Any More Boring Art. It's a piece of work that was produced in 1971. Art and Language, a group of artists, also started to be extremely active at the end of the 60s. They started by publishing this Art and Language Journal of Conceptual Art in May 69. And as you can see here, you also have an essay by Sol Lewitt and a couple of other things. It was also the end of the golden age of the pop art. Here you see the work, a paintbrush by Roy Lichtenstein. This brush was obviously a critique of the action painting artist and also late expressionist art, because Roy Lichtenstein was really putting this extremely dynamic shape in the most static manner. So it was a very humoristic critique of all the action painting and all of the kind of arts that were, let's say, oriented toward psychological behavior. It was also the year, 69 was also a year where, let's say, pop art started to become something else. Here you see the work of Dick Higgins that was also published in a book in 1969, it's a work by Paul Bury, but the book was published by Dick Higgins in the Fantastic Architecture book in 1969. So the context was also the one of the end of optical art. Here you see a work by Julian Stanczak in 1963. And here you see the work of Bridget Riley, which according to me is definitely the very best artist in op art in the 50s and early 60s. On a more architectural level, the context was the one of Yona Friedman. You see here the flat writer, which was making use of a computer to create apartments and any kinds of architectural shapes and dwellings. It was started in 1967 and it ended up until 1973. It was also the context of David George Emrich, who published a book called Soft Architecture. David George Emrich, as you can see here on the right, you see he made a reference to the printed circuit on the top right, and he published this in 1968 in France. Emrich was teaching at the École des Beaux-Arts, and I don't know if Manfred Mohr had the opportunity to meet and discuss with David George Emrich, but it might have been the case. So Emrich was extremely critical regarding late rationalism, and you see here he said that Dupont has lost reason, which means that Dupont is a typical French name. But it was also a famous brand of luxury cigarette lighter. And he was making this critique, he used this photomontage to make a critique of the squares and very simple and stupid shapes that were created by late rationalist architect. So Emrich was himself interested in lighter architecture, more geometric, but also more influenced by nature and by all the different soft system that we could find everywhere in the world, including, for example, here in Africa, where he runs some experiments. And here you can see also Emrich with a couple of very famous engineers, including Robert Marie Collet, but also Konrad Wachsmann, who was a famous architect working on structure. So Emrich was developing this kind of component. And here you see a page of what Emrich was doing at that moment. But again, I would need more time to investigate if there was some relationship between Emrich and Manfred Mohr. But just keep in mind that they were exactly at the same time in the same school in Paris. Also on an architectural level, the context was the one of Andrea Bronzi, who published these drawings in 1967 and 1968. So he was also interested in notation. The context was also the one of Nicolas Negroponte, who first published the architectural machine, but later on in 1975, 2 years after Emrich published its own book entitled Soft Architecture, Nicolas Negroponte published a kind of sequel to the architectural machine entitled Soft Architecture Machine. So it was published, both were published at MIT. In terms of our more classical, let's say, or less computational architecture, I mean, it was not properly computational architecture, but let's say architecture influenced by early digital experiment and tools. The work of John Heiduck was produced in between 63 and 67. You can see here, Peter Eisenman was also influenced by the work of Sol Lewitt, and he published his Notes on Conceptual Architecture in 1970. And he made this work for House 4 in 1971. As we will see, this can be also put in relation with the work of Manfred Mohr, or more precisely, the other way around. And ultimately, also in 1968 until 1971, Hiromi Fuji in Japan produced this absolutely beautiful piece of conceptual architecture. If you see the drawings by Hiromi Fuji, they are just absolutely mesmerizing. Later, the architectural context was the one of Cedric Price with a generator project in 1976, as you can see here. And in 1978, it was the year when George Steiny and James Gibbs published Algorithmic Aesthetics, Computer Models for Criticism and Design in the Art, where they introduced the shape grammars and a couple of other highly influential tools. So the theoretical position of Manfred Mohr were influenced by the one of Max Benz. As I explained before, Benz was a rationalist philosopher. He started by writing in 1934, Raum und Ich, which means space and I, Spence and myself, let's say. And later he published on the influence of mathematics in art, as you can see here on the right. So Manfred Mohr was explicitly speaking about using the machine as an extension of ourself. Regarding that, he was very much in line with Marshall McLuhan, but he quoted Marshall McLuhan, by the way, in his own writing. It was not like plagiarism or anything like that. It was a very clear reference. In his writing, he insisted on the idea of precision, as you can see here. Oops, sorry. on the idea of precision, but also insisted on the concept of man-machine dialogue, as you can see here in this piece of writing. So I extracted the most important quotes from Manfred Mohr. He said that the fundamental view is that machines should not be considered as a challenge to humanity, but like McLuhan predicted, as an extension of ourselves in the basic philosophy when becoming involved with technology. He also said that a technology which functions has to be integrated in our lives like a physical extension, a necessity of our body and our mind. There's too many misunderstandings in human-machine relationship that are created by the lack of knowledge and the categorical refusal to learn. So for Manfred Mohr, it was extremely important to learn new knowledge. And this is also why he really wanted to learn the Fortran for programming language by himself, not just doing collaborative work. He famously said that that one should simply be ready to leave the most possible part of the work to a machine when it becomes clear that in this way the desired solution may be better and more reliably achieved. He also said that it's true that human thought can be amplified by machine, and that aesthetical research runs, from this point at least, parallel to scientific research. So for Manfred Mohr, what was important was this idea of an extension of our brain, of ourself, and also the issue of learning and the issue of amplification of our own thinking by the help of the machine. He insisted on a couple of concepts on a more technical and visual level. He insisted on the distinction between the visual and concrete procedure and the statistical flexible procedure. His work is clearly showing a big difference between those concepts. He also insisted on the issue of visualization of mathematical formulas. He believed that this was interesting in itself. For that, it can be considered quite close, but not so close to Mel Bochner, because Mel Bochner was also very much interested in making things visible, especially in his very famous exhibition in 1966, Walking Drawings and Other Visible Things on Paper, Not Necessarily Meant to be Viewed as Art. This exhibition was famous because it's considered the very first exhibition on conceptual art, and also an exhibition which is radically destroying the aura of the art, because it's only Xerox reproduction of work. There's nothing original. These catalogs here are they are all the same. So it's the first exhibition that made use of a Xerox reproduction machine. So we can see some analogies, but also some differences between the work of Manfred Mohr and some work by American artists like Mel Bochner. But in any case, for Manfred Mohr, here are the important aspects of the art is developing. The precision should be considered as part of aesthetical expression. The high speed of execution should be considered. The fact that hundreds of imposed orders and statistical consideration can also be carried out by a computer instead of by the human mind, which is incapable of retaining them over a period of time. It's very important because here we really see that he understood probably the most important parameter of the digital, which is the speed, the capability of making things and producing an infinite amount of things that a human mind cannot cope with. And finally, he was interested in the continuous feedback during a man-machine dialogue, which involved a learning process on the side of the human being. So again, this learning process is absolutely key in the work of Manfred Mohr. All of that was considered quite positively in the newspaper. And finally, recently, Manfred Mohr wrote a paper on generative art you can easily find online, where he explained what was his thinking. So finally, the visual exploration of Manfred Mohr, they encompass different styles and I would say almost domain. He started as an almost as a kind of expressionist artist when he was really young, when he was still studying art in art school. You can see this on the left, this ink, these drops of ink. But then as you can see on the right, he started to use the computer to be more rigorous. So you can see this also in this image, which is kind of, in this plot, sorry, which is kind of interesting. This one as well, all produced in 1970 and presented in the famous exhibition in Paris in 1971. You can see here on the left and then in a computerized version on the right, an influence of Kandinsky. It's kind of obvious that Manfred Mohr was very much influenced by Kandinsky, especially in his early work. You see some resemblance. Of course, they didn't know each other, but you see, for example, here the work of Mohr that was produced in 1969, in the US. And here you see an house that was built by Richard Mayer, the Hoffman House, also at the late 60s. So in fact, in this work, you still see the influence of the, let's say, the highly geometric forms of both constructivism and also of the Ulm school in Switzerland, but also of the art concret. At some point, which even if it was more physical and materialistic, didn't abandon the rigor of geometry, of classical geometry. In this work here of Mohr, you can also see the influence of Sol Lewitt that you see here. So this work by Sol Lewitt was produced in 1974, and this work by Manfred Mohr was produced in 1975. So you clearly see the influence of Lewitt on Manfred Mohr, but they were both using completely different methods because again, Manfred Mohr was doing this thanks to the computer, thanks to a program, which was not the case in this work. Being done by Sol Lewitt. Also, Sol Lewitt was more interested in the physical manifestation of this, while Manfred Mohr was definitely not that interested in the physicality of the art, even if he produced a couple of physical pieces, but very, very few. Here you see that Mohr was also interested in everything having to do with mathematics, not just geometry. Here on the left, you have a representation of the logical operation NOR, and on the right, a representation of many operations that are based on the OR logical operator. So just to give you an idea of what it is, here you see the truth tables of these logical operators. This is really the basic of propositional calculus. Nothing complex at all. It's just like negation, implication, disjunction, conjunction, and implication and combined implication. Here you see the same thing according to the conceptual notation invented by Gottlob Frege at the end of the 19th century, and also the same operation as described by Gardner in the famous Gardner network diagrams. Later, at the very end of the 70s and early 90s, you see the work of Manfred Mohr is slightly changing in terms of aesthetics. It becomes a bit more deconstructed, let's say. It's influenced by deconstructivism or deconstructionism, if we speak about philosophy. We can see this here. Personally, I very much enjoy that. I believe it's quite good, especially these pieces. I mean, my favorite pieces are probably this one. I really find them extremely interesting and beautiful. Also because physically speaking, they are made of extremely cheap materials. So it creates a very interesting link with arte povera, I would say, almost, even if, of course, it's quite different. And here you see a couple of physical manifestation of what Manfred Mohr was producing. But as I said, it's very rare that Manfred Mohr is really doing something which is physical. Here you see the deconstructivist period of Manfred Mohr, which in fact is also associated with the use of more advanced computer and the capability of visualizing more complex things on personal computers. So here, there's no need to use punch card or anything like that. It's obviously, we can obviously see some zeitgeist resemblance between this work of Manfred Mohr and the work of Peter Eiselman that would follow in the late 80s. In fact, Mohr was interested in different things. Here is a work of Mohr which is extremely analytical. You see, it's a pure decomposition of the element that create a certain specific shape. I believe this work is also extremely exquisite. But we can see some, let's say, resemblance or influence. Again, it's not necessarily influences. I would say it's more of a kind of zeitgeist, again. When we look at this work of Manfred Mohr and when we look at the work of Bernard Tschumi about notation, as we can see here. And finally, I will end with the use of randomness by Manfred Mohr. Here in 1970, Manfred Mohr was created hexagrams, representation of hexagrams on a plotter in Paris. Just to give you an idea, the hexagrams, of course, the Chinese students know really well what it is about. But for the non-Chinese student, I give a quick explanation. It's purely combinatorial, sorry. It's a bit mystical, but as always, mystics is quite often associated with combinatorics. Don't ask me why, but it's always the case in history. It was the case for Ramon Llull in Spain in 13th century and early 14th century. No, sorry, 12th century and 13th century. It's also the case in China, and it's still the case today. It seems that combinatorics is metaphysics almost by essence. But anyway, when we have a more rigorous mathematical look at what it is, it's nothing else than a tree. Which explores the different possibilities of what we can do. So in that, the use of randomness and combinatorics by Manfred Mohr is slightly different from the use of also combinatorics and randomness by some other artists, including John Cage, for example, because when John Cage was using the hexagrams, he was really using them in a more radically random manner. Again, here we can see some clear differences between Mohr and some other artists making use of the same conceptual tools. Finally, regarding pure randomness, He was not the first one to use randomness in his artwork. Here we see a work of the French artist. I have the name. I forgot it. I get it again. Sorry. François Morlet. Okay. Finally, I got it. So it's a work by François Morlet in 1960, and it's a random distribution that was of odd and even numbers. It's 40,000 squares, and for the production of this work, François Morlet used a telephone directory. And if the end number was odd, he put it in blue. And if the last number of the telephone number was even, he put it, he colored the square in red. So this is really a very interesting example of use of random numbers, because it's almost, we would consider it today as almost a perfect randomness. I really believe that if we would run some tests on the randomness quality of this, it would be extremely convincing. And later in 1967, some other artists like Frieder Nacke, who was also involved in computer art, was also making use of randomness. So yeah, this is a quick sketchy presentation of the work of Manfred Mohr. Thanks a lot.
Thanks so much, Philippe. This was an amazing journey, a very generous and expansive journey through Manfred Mohr and through a much larger scope of how computation has been used by artists and architects in different moments. And I think you draw amazing connections. I mean, I almost feel like this should be a book that doesn't exist. We need this book. I mean, I think the space of an essay in a journal is going to be extremely poor for the scope of this. No, I truly think it's, even if we just kind of like keep it to the analysis of Manfred Mohr, from the little research that I've done, I mean, the analysis of the bit where you spoke about Fortran and how you then mapped out how Fortran was used by other practices and in which way by Doxiadis, this draws really deep connections. And I think it's an amazing cultural history of computation that we absolutely need. And in fact, I also loved how you ended on this connection between combinatronics and mysticism, because it's kind of brought me back to the very idea of the title of this seminar today. Because with the idea of form, for me, form is something that has to do with symbolism. And so it's important to understand, at some point you mentioned how Manfred Mohr was interested in not Manfred Mohr, but the American artist.
Mel Buckner,
who was interested in the kind of manifestation, the visual manifestation of mathematics. And how also Manfred Mohr, I mean, I think if we look at the language of these drawings, which were the result of specific computational and a specific computer language, how they seem to our eyes today, almost, we take them almost for granted, and aesthetically and visually, and the visual language is something that we're familiar with. But of course, back then, it was completely, was an exploration that, as you said, many people were doing. In fact, in the journal, we will have also an interview by Ansulich Obrist with Getulio Albiani, who was with the more famous internationally, Enzo Mari, part of Arte Programmata, which was another group that in the 60s kind of tried to use the same things, similar tools. So, even, so it's interesting because, you mentioned that, yes, Manfred Mohr was programming himself, whereas other artists didn't. For example, Sol Lewitt didn't at all and wasn't using a computer at all, as far as we know. But there is almost an idea of a language or a sensibility that develops, even if it's completely analogic, to this to the innovations brought about by machines and computation. And I think we can transport this to today. And I think what I'm interested in this discussion, and we saw it in all the presentations, is not exclusively work that has been done with a computer per se, or using, let's say, proficiency in coding, but also how this can influence the practice of designing, making spaces. I mean, going back to architecture, making spaces, constructing the human habitat. I think we extended a little bit the time, but I would be super happy to open up the discussion. I think there is a wealth of strands that we could pick up on. So I'm gonna maybe leave space to you guys, to the speakers, if you want to start drawing some connections, and otherwise I will step in. I have a few questions and connections that I want to make. If everyone is still there, by the way, because we're a bit we extended a bit our time. No, everyone is still there, seems like. You know, I don't know how you guys want to intervene. I think Philippe was amazing to end with Philippe, because of course it also gave us a big platform to understand culturally how all these different things played out. We also was amazing today because we really dwelled in different time frames, timelines, one would say more fashionably today. And I think there is amazing, overlaps and connections that really allow us to expand on this. And I really want to stress out also for our guests, for the people listening, that I think actually there is not so much work being done in this direction of understanding this cultural impact. I mean, Philippe mentioned quite a few moments, exhibitions that are, in fact, legendary because there are so few. So there is a few moments where, of course, the role of technology and computation has been understood in its cultural implications. But actually, even today, I mean, we see, the other day I was at another panel, another symposium, where actually we discussed algorithms and their impact on culture at large. And there was actually so much. In my view, you know, being someone who's also not—I don't consider myself to be the most literate on the subject—but I find that there is a lot of illiteracy that leads to a lot of paranoia that actually doesn't. And this is something that I was surprised to find in Manfred Mohr already in the 60s. This idea that we need to push for literacy, because actually this is an extension; it's a tool that extends our capability. And I think, especially to the end of architecture, you know, I mean, I think Federico, speaking about the work of his studio, really clarified that in a very direct and visible way on how we can use applications of computational tools today that, you know, on the design part but also on the management part, and how these two things can be harmonized through technology. It's an amazing development that, you know, Manfred Mohr would be let's say happy about in terms as far as the literacy on the subject goes. So I'm very happy that today we collectively contribute to this history and to this and add some I keep saying often the word, let's say, hermeneutic tools, so tools for understanding computational design and computational tools, and how they can be integrated also in established methodologies, which is also another urgent conversation, is how, because, you know, it's how we integrate new tools in existing methodologies. For example, the work on Moretti, I was really interested in seeing the exhibition at the Triennale, where he actually proposed a few buildings Because, for example, even on that, even analyzing that only that exhibition, we can see how, for example, certain parametric tools were used for certain specific typologies of buildings. So, you know, Moretti, you know, could have applied this to anything, but he chose to apply it to certain large-scale urban infrastructures, such as a sports arena, a cinema. So things that we understand as like large objects, large single objects that can be and actually this, you know, to the end of your presentation, Marco, you said like we cannot compute, we need to understand the scale of algorithms and how far they can go, basically. Sure. I'm bastardizing a bit.
Maybe if I can actually
please, go ahead.
Intervene. I think, yes, in retrospect, I guess, you know, Moretti focused on typologies that fast forward 50 years, are, you know, typically parametric now, right? I mean, because they're more or less monofunctional. You know, a stadium is nowadays is no longer monofunctional, but essentially it is actually designed to be looking at the pitch, and therefore, you know, it kind of develop into, you know, the most parametric, you know, typology. But Moretti, you know, I'm not sure how aware he was that. Of that actually, also because I think at the time the stadium itself was a rather new typology, no, in the world of architecture, in a way, you know, sport, you know, like the massification of, you know, sport and so on. So I think, but yeah, it's definitely very interesting. The other thing I want to say is that regarding the discussion, and I'll just throw it there. Perhaps you can, we take it for granted, but I think for many, many years, computational design, algorithmic design, especially from the early 90s, is never really been confronting itself with the past. You know, everything was more or less taken for granted, or, you know, sort of like as if it was developed in a vacuum, let's say, right? As if it just came out of nowhere, and of course it's understandable, you know, because obviously architects were all very excited and they wanted to kind of experiment and bring this new technology to fruition, to start building, you know, the economy at the time was better perhaps than today. So there was a series of things that were converging, let's say. But what I find particularly important, and at some point it was actually really necessary, is to kind of like go back and see that, you know, eventually there is a legacy there, and there is a tradition, which is a very, you know, noble tradition of architecture as we know it, and it's not just like a bunch of like, you know, punks that they play with computers. So that's in terms of like the cultural relevance, let's say, of the discussion. Then, of course, you know, we can say that, you know, we always been parametric, or, you know, architecture itself is a discipline that is about, like, you know, the idea of, like, you know, establishing algorithmic procedure to get something built. Mm-hmm.
I think the novelty, I mean, we should perhaps understand it. And I think Manfred Moore's work really helps us with that, is that it's perhaps just the idea of encoding certain processes that have always been part of architecture, the possibility of encoding them and then potentially automating them or doing something else with them is what machines allow us to do. But that doesn't necessarily change how we think about it, or, you know, it's not the, and, you know, I want to stress the fact that what you say about the importance of history, of how we're trying to reconnect or rebuild bridges. I feel like for some parts of the discourse on the digital and computation, perhaps it's as if history started in the Bell laboratories or something like that. Like it started in, like, in the US with the beginning of mass computers and stuff like that. But of course, you know, I mean, I think Roberto, of course, has done a lot of work on building these bridges and making us understand also how the bridges go a lot further back in time, in fact.
I want to just maybe a quick one. It's what, I don't know, I keep thinking about what Philippe said a second ago, and why combinatorial logic keeps going metaphysical. And I think it's a side note, but I can't stop myself. I have to say it, sorry. There are two ways to look at it. One, it's that you're totally right, Philippe. Yeah, Lul is the point of reference in this conversation, and Lulism, again, if we're talking about bridges that were burnt in history, there's definitely a vague understanding of the importance of Lulism. How could it be that a person that invents concentric wheels that wants to basically convince Muslims that their religion is inferior has a lasting effect throughout Europe for over 300 years? I mean, it's not explainable as a joke. And I would say this is perhaps interesting because it is a computational project, is no doubt about it. And it's very interesting because computation sits at a moment in history where other notational, non-visual, non-mimetic, in fact, the word should be, non-mimetic way of articulating reality and knowledge emerge. Mm-hmm. And that was interesting for Philippe because, I mean, I say Philippe, but obviously, you know, many of the presentations is just the last one we saw. So we tend to have short-term memory working better than long-term memory. It was interesting, for instance, in Manfred Moore, this constant tension between the visual and the conceptual. And I think that is what one of the interesting promises of computation historically for a very long period of time, a system to articulate something that lies between the intelligible and the sensible. Yeah, something that cannot quite be sensed and yet needs to make very clear to the mind. So this tension, the fact that combinatorial logic always tends to be in that realm is probably something that has to do with that. Obviously, you could also look at it a different way. You could say, well, combinatorial logic is sort of a simple mathematical game that could be grasped a lot earlier in history than other more advanced mathematical models. Or you could also relate it to the fact that for some reason, the Christian tradition forgot the first commandment. Yeah, because we should not really be able to draw God. But we decided to ignore it for reasons that are not entirely clear to me. And the Kabbalistic tradition did not ignore it. And the Kabbalistic tradition is a notational system for symbolic articulation of the world without generating images. I think all I want to say is that the short comment that Philippe made in passing is quite, could be, yeah, I've not thought it through myself entirely, but could be quite powerful, in fact.
I want to pick up on this quickly because I think there is this, I mean, I love that this took a theological dimension, but it's really, I think, crucial, and I've been wanting to ask this question on this idea of the visual and the conceptual, because even in the work of Manfred Moore, I think there is, you know, when you talked about this passage from when his work was purely code, and in fact in the exhibition there was a printing machine and just printing whatever was coming out of the program, and then later on in the 80s with the development of visual interfaces, his work became different, and in fact you connected it to the work of Peter Eisenman. So I'm wondering something that it's really a key question for me. So today, of course, softwares are popularized. Even there is, you know, visual computation, visual algorithms, is possible through software such as Grasshopper. You know, there is aids to, let's say, an understanding of a visual means through code, let's say. So, and I'm interested in this because for a long time, the discourse on computation and architecture was purely on data. You know, how do we get data? What is the data? How do we structure data? But today we're in a different environment where, you know, softwares are more developed, are more accessible, and people don't necessarily think about what's in the back, in the black box. But nevertheless, what comes out, for me, when I look at it again, I can only understand it as computational. And there is, I think, and then, you know, even more so when it's informed by a language, by a culture of digital, by the culture of digital tools. So I'm really curious to see your position on this, like whether you see that, you know, where are we going in a sense? Like, is visual computation comparable to a purely, let's say, algebraic or coded computation? You know, can we compare the two? Can the two coexist? Sorry, not super well formulated.
Who is supposed to answer the question? Roberto or any of us?
You, I mean, Philippe, from you, I would love to hear your answer to this. But obviously, this is extended to everyone.
I don't know, Roberto, you want to start?
I think it touches everyone pretty much.
No, please, Philippe, go ahead. Thank you.
No, I mean, first, just a very quick note on this metaphysical issue associated with combinatorics. My feeling is that at that moment in time, you know, in the 13th century or 12th century, it was a bit extraordinary to be able to demonstrate that only a few numbers of parameters could lead to so many possibilities. So I think there's some magics for the people who know nothing about mathematics. There's some magic associated with combinatorics, at least at that time in history. Of course, today we look at that as something which is pretty simple, and we are not surprised anymore by anything having to do with combinatorics, and we are probably more impressed by some other domains of mathematics, more conceptual. But clearly, I would say in the 12th century, it was impressive. There was some magics into it. And my feeling is that if it's a bit associated with metaphysics, it's also because there is some intrinsic magics in this combinatorial explosion at some point. But anyway, I mean, it's just a very sketchy hypothesis. Regarding the question by Alessandro, no, I believe that visual programming is not like more standard programming where we use code, you know, symbols. Because I think, I mean, it creates the same effect, but I would say probably the intellectual operations are not exactly the same. And also the feeling we have is not exactly the same, because in one case we do things, it's a much more visual operation, you know. When you do visual programming, it's a bit like putting some order in a PowerPoint presentation, you know, like you shift some slide until it makes sense. But when you do programming by writing code, I think it's maybe a slightly more analytic approach, or maybe simply, it's more textural, you know, it's more, it's more text-based, I would say.
Agreed. My question is then to the end of making architecture, like, because, you know, of course I understand what you're saying, it's very different. The two things are very different, but to the end of making architecture, like, you know, in terms to the end of what is useful for architecture, because if I look, for example, at someone like Fundamenta, like Federico, you know, they use computational tools, but the input is very much like a curve that is drawn and is the input data to then different kinds of processes. Then you can, then the one curve can start influencing how the other curves are drawn and things like that. But there is, you know, there is an input that is drawn, you know, whereas like in a lot of computation, the discourse on computational design, there is always this question, even the work academically at the Bartlett, you know, I've been teaching there, there's always this question of where does the data come from? And it has, and sometimes it's almost like a theological question, but it has to come from some God-given numerical formula. So I'm interested in this question. I think it's quite a central question methodologically.
Yeah. So I would say, probably we are entering an era in which the data is becoming more important than the algorithms. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know if it's true, scientifically speaking, by the way, mm-hmm. but at least the mindset is maybe in favor of a deeper influence of the data over the influence of the algorithms. You know, maybe, I don't know, but again, it's definitely not a scientific statement. It's more it's more something which also probably because it's much easier to associate the data to everything which is happening in the society at large. Yes. You know, while for example, we know the data of Facebook because we see them every day. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't see all of the data, but I mean, we see how it works, but we don't know the algorithms mm-hmm. they are using. So probably, even if I believe that the science of algorithm, algorithmic science is probably more developed than more advanced than ever. It's mm-hmm. absolutely crazy, the complexity of algorithmic science today. But let's say most people don't have a grasp on that. So this is why maybe we can say that on an everyday basis, the data seems more important in today's society.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with that. Perhaps it's also it's because also certain, let's say, algorithmic blocks are more available. I can bring the example of my students last year. They would take existing, let's say, machine learning procedures, then completely change the data set to an architectural data set, for example, on architectural typologies, and then they would tweak the machine learning black box to adjust the output to what they needed it to do. So in a way, like, this is a different approach. I mean, I scientifically is not a purist approach to computation, but ultimately, at least for what I'm interested in, is how can we use, even if it's about using blocks and bits, how can we then tweak them to be useful for us as designers? That's at least my point of view on that. Guys, is there more comments or something or questions that you guys want to ask? Also from the audience, if the remaining proud 60 people want to ask, which is amazing. We had a pretty amazing rate of people not dropping out, I would say. If there is questions, please go ahead, because we will wrap up soon, because I think we're extended our time quite a lot.
Actually, when you were asking the question about facial computation versus algebraic coded computation, I wasn't exactly sure like why it was asked as a question, maybe because it's 1 a.m. But when you were asking that, it actually reminded me of John Nash. you know, the guy who got Nobel Prize for game theory. But actually when he was 25, before he went crazy, he was actually famous for doing the embedding theorem. So looking at high dimensional object and whether you can actually embed it to any Euclidean space, right? And he got really famous for that. We usually visualize this sort of embedding, which is like a donut, and then you have a lot of wave flowing through the donut. But actually when they interviewed John Nash, everything in his brain was numbers. Like he was never really official person. And when people interviewed him for his schizophrenia, he completely hated the movie Beautiful Mind because he didn't see things. Like his schizophrenic was the miracle. And I mean, that's crazy to a very banal brain of mine, but so I don't really see the visual and the algebraic as either or. And also if you look at Chinese maths, as Philip also showed, the entire book of change, I chain where the hexagram was in, it was not visual. They literally documented everything with Chinese character. And it's like crazy when you have to read through that, because Chinese is an agricultural nation. So we measure everything pragmatically. The math is metaphysical, but we're measuring like the meters of the soil, how much rain we need in the book of I Ching, and they would write down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in that complex character. And people still manage to, you know, do the geometrical calculation in their mind, which is crazy. And to talk about the data of Facebook, there is always this privacy ethical question that I agree is becoming theological and inescapable, but maybe it's just because of the mindset that we feel like we're always dependent on the centralized platform, but we're actually making a sort of trade, right? We surrender the data because they're doing social service for us, computational service that was hard to do as an individual. So maybe the mindset is, as opposed to passively surrendering data, is there a way to actively contribute data so that we get over with the data privacy problem? Right.
For example, I mean, I was thinking about how, for example, data on architecture is scarce. Like when we did this research on typologies, like it's really hard to find this data. Like, where do you go? You need to go, I mean, you need to go in like the old registries of each city to find the undigitized maps and try to redraw them and things like that. So it's we also live in that reality. And also when you mentioned the abstraction versus visual, I was reminded of my dad, who is a computer programmer, in his early career was a computer programmer, and how he always says he sees numbers and not visual things. So now for me this is like slightly triggering on some levels. Is there any more comments or questions?
But it's actually like CAPTCHA, right? What they really do is that they don't hire an intern to label the data set, but instead it creates the economy over validating humans.
Yes.
And it match make two problems. And
yeah, we're waiting for a startup to deal with the architecture even so that
label doors and windows for BIM and everything to validate your human. Yeah.
Exactly. That perhaps is a good implementation. All right. I'm kind of feeling that I will close this amazing session today here, just because, again, we were meant to finish at 5. I'm really grateful to all of you for your contributions. And again, this is only, let's say, today was a kind of amazing and stellar way to present the journal that will come out next year. So thank you so much for this discussion. It's really precious. A lot of ideas were really fruitful to kind of really amplifying the conversation on computational design, which, as we've seen, augmenting the literacy and the discourse and the different threads on it, and even the historical grounding of this discourse is fundamental. So thank you so much. And thanks to all the people listening, the ones left. I will see you guys soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it was great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
See you guys soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.